Because as a deer, can you rotate it? Can you do it, April, or do we need Eli? You can do it? Okay. Hey, just follow along on the board up here. Let's sing, "As a deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after you." Just, there's the words. If you remember it, join, sing with me. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone doth my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Verse number 2, you're my friend and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than anything. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. I guess I wasn't holding yield. I was holding it and stopping it there for you instead of a half note, but I'd like, we did pretty good. 463 in the hymn book is "All That Thrills My Soul." 463. Well, thanks for coming back to second service. We'll get right into it there. And as soon as our special music walks in, it's Alex this morning. He's coming in here. Wait till he comes in and I scare him. You're special music today, right, partner? Yeah. Nice purse you got there, going to accessorize very well. How about we sing two verses of it? It's a good song. Who can cheer the heart like Jesus? How about we just go ahead and use verse 1 and verse number 5? We'll do that. I hear a happy camper over the next door. Who can cheer the heart like Jesus, by his presence all divine? True and tender, pure and precious, oh, how blessed to call him mine. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me, and the fairest of 10,000 in my blessed Lord I see. By the crystal flowing river, by the crystal flowing river, with the ransomed I will see. And forever and forever praise and glorify the King. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me, and the fairest of 10,000 is. We'll be in Matthew chapter 24. I have split up in another portion or two the Wednesday night Bible study because I got almost to the main point on Wednesday nights, temple to temple. Well, all of them were main points. It really were. Solomon's temple compared to the new temple. What? Know you not that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, which you have of God, and you're not your own? For you're bought with a price. Wherefore? I think they both work. Therefore, glorify God in your body, which are Christ. Matthew 24. Here's a verse, a famous verse or two about the temple. Just verse 1 and 2. I'm just about there. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple. And his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. I've used as a title, Losing the Temple. I think a fuller title was Losing the Temple Treasures. I believe they could say that it will fit with a lesson if I put those two together and say, first losing the temple treasures, then eventually losing the temple itself. Both that would work. The study of Solomon's temple on Wednesday night, the first intention of the tabernacle and the temple was, God said, make me a dwelling place, a sanctuary, and there I will dwell with you. Then in another verse he said, that I may meet with you there. The idea that God had instituted with plans, that tabernacle, and then eventually the permanent temple, was he wanted a designated place for God's people to meet with him. And he could dwell with them and among them. The great likeness in the New Testament in Hebrews, who said these things, the law, the tabernacle, temple, were a shadow of the things to come. There is a prescribed way to meet God. There will I meet with you there. You have to come the Jesus way. You have to come through the one door. You have to come by the one sacrifice. You have to come through the one cleansing. You have to come by the bread of life. You have to come by the light of the world. You have to come by the sweet-smelling savor unto God. You have to have that veil rent in twain before you come to that ark where God says, I'll meet with you there. And that's briefly catching up. But I know, and you know from being in church long enough, Israel would lose those temples. Somewhere, who knows, those curtains and those tents or those cloths that made up the tabernacle are long gone. And we know, just from being in church long enough, Solomon's temple in all its glory ceased to exist. I look back up to see the seven wonders of the ancient world and say they only have records of the Colossus of Rhodes. Could you imagine a statue that was like five times taller than the Statue of Liberty, standing with its feet on the separation of the Adriatic Sea and the Caspian Sea, I believe. Could you imagine a statue built that was five times the Statue of Liberty to guard the passageway and the glory of Greece? I wonder how they even built it. Except if I study, they built embankments of soil up to it, and as they build it, they remove the soil. That's unbelievable. I mentioned Wednesday night, the Great Wall of China. Can you imagine 5,000 miles of 30, 40-foot wall of stone? Also called, the secondary title, Great Wall of China, is the world's longest cemetery. Over 1 million people give their lives in building it. Could you imagine? You know how, if we wanted to go, well, I know this. If we wanted to go from this church to the doorstep where we lived in Lakeland, Florida, you had to travel 814 miles. That's in the middle of the state. If we wanted to go down to Miami, Florida, we have to travel right at 1,100 miles. Could you imagine building a wall that's another 1,000 miles longer than that through the terrain of West Virginia? Amazing, isn't it, to consider such a thing? So I use that in this thought. It is a wonder, the ancient world, the Great Wall of China. It is a wonder, the Colossus of Rhodes. And that's just two of them that mention this. Solomon's temple, though not on the original list, was considered part of another wonder, the ancient world. Can you imagine Could you imagine the building of that, that when it would shine for miles away, people would see the gold shine into the sky and know that that's where the temple of Solomon was. The comparison of Solomon's temple Wednesday night, he just briefly mentioned that it was wondrously made. What? Know that you're not, that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. One of the great wonders of the world and the science world, that not even to go back and rehearse everything, is how your body is created in such a way that even the scientists from Clemson University said there's not a chance that it evolved. Not a chance. When I read that on Wednesday night, your body is wondrously made. I will praise thee, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made, David said. And thou seest my substance before they fashioned in the lowest parts of earth, before they were even complete, where they were still imperfect or unperfect. Yet God fashioned us there and made us a wondrous, amazing temple. We realize that it was of great cost. Solomon's temple took 30,000 bearers, laborers, gophers, as we say in today's construction site. It took 50,000 men in the stone quarries. It took 80,000 men in the transportation and hewing of the wood and getting it across. It had a grand total of 180,000 laborers. It had 3,300, the book 1 Kings tells us, of overseers. Can you imagine the food? Can you imagine the logistics? Can you imagine the encampments? When I see the Civil War encampment pictures, you just like, oh, isn't that neat seeing all those little white tents laid out in the field, you know, 1,000 of them. Yeah, and then my mind goes back about the food supply, then also the sanitation and the fresh water. All it takes. The military is an amazing thing. When you talk about all that it takes to move 1,000 men, maybe a battalion, from here to there, all that's involved with that, somebody has to be. But the cost. He said, well, I don't like paying my taxes. And, I sit there at the gas pump, and I'm sitting there, what is it now, about 54 cents worth on a gallon of federal tax. You're sitting there going, ding, 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 ding. Yeah, but that's what keeps that aircraft carrier out to sea. That keeps them F-35s in the air. I know there's a lot of things I wish I wasn't paying for, but I'm thankful for that. That's what keeps your police department up and down the streets, your sheriff department up and down the streets. See? Solomon raised a levy. Yep, had big taxation on all the people to pay for. The big debate when Rehoboam came on the throne was, are you going to lighten the taxes? And his young men advised him, you just tell him, no, if you think my father's burden was heavy, I'm going to double it up. It was a tax rebellion. Part of it, but to give you an idea, the Solomon's temple was costly. What? Know you not that your body's a temple of the Holy Ghost, which you have of God, that you're not your own. You were bought with a price. And if the first temple was not only wondrous, it was also very expensive. And I'm going to tell you what, for you to be a redeemed child of God, it cost God the life of his son. And I don't know of a greater cost than that. So just to give you back up to say these, and I'll go through them rather quickly here. It's something, he said, that our bodies now is a temple of God. A reminder of, in the Ten Commandments, the ominous beginning of how things can be lost. And we did this in the study, but if I go to, now let me just give you the passages for the time. In Exodus 33:3-7, the Ten Commandments, the first set were broke ere they came down off the mountain. And here comes Moses and Joshua with a set of the Ten Commandments hewn by the finger of God. He sees the revelry. He sees the party. What he sees is the idolatry. They have a golden calf. And those first commandments, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images. Thou shalt not use the Lord thy God's name in vain. Remember Sabbath day, keep it holy. The first of the four of the Ten Commandments. It wasn't a holy day down there on the field. It wasn't using God's name with reverence, and that it was a holy name. They're using it in quite vanity. It wasn't that there was no keeping no graven images. They had already made a calf image for an unseen God, and they weren't loving the Lord thy God. They had an image of Egypt's God before them with all their heart and soul and mind. And Moses, in his anger, what did he do? He cast down the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments were broke, you say, before they were hot off the press, right? The Ten Commandments were all broke before they were ever set in the ark. And then Moses would later be commanded to hew a second set of stones, and God would write on those, and those were put in the ark. But it's an ominous beginning, but that's not the only part of it. In Exodus chapter 33, verse 7, God said, I'll dwell with you there. And he would give specific instructions of where the tent would be set up, or the tabernacle. And it'd be the center of attention, and the tribes, how they would encamp about it in certain ways. But you know, with that idolatrous party, you know where the tabernacle was first set up? This one I think I better read. Exodus chapter 33, verse 7. And Moses took the tabernacle. This is after that infamous breaking of the law and the party and the plague at the foot of Mount Sinai. And Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it without the camp, far off from the camp, and called it the tabernacle of the congregation. And it came to pass that everyone which sought the Lord went out into the tabernacle of the congregation, which was without the camp. You see what's mentioned here? Nope, it's not the center of attention. It's not the focus of people's worship. First one had to set it out way off, far off. You want to go meet with God, you had to go way out. Kind of an ominous beginning about how God's presence and how God's treasures, how the center of attention and worship and God's being with the people, already from the beginning, the commandments are broke and the tents moved out of camp. Kind of get an idea. That to say this, Solomon's temple, one of the great wonders of the ancient world. The queen from the south, who said when she saw all the different things of Solomon's reign, proved him with hard questions, and then came to the point of seeing his ascent to the worship of God's house, was left spiritless, was left without breath, and would make the famous statement, the half has not been told. Silver in Jerusalem as gravel. Cedar trees of Lebanon, majestic, beautiful trees, as the sycamore trees of the vale. They're in abundance along the river. These majestic trees were in abundance in Jerusalem. You see, how about, who was the designer? Olmsted was his name, of Central Park, New York. Who had the vision to realize that someday it'd be a great metropolis? So to keep some country and to keep some rural setting, that would design Central Park in New York and already know how to have a place for people to get away so they can go and say, oh, this is how pretty it can be or used to be. Who had that vision? You know, so I just say this as an example. Jerusalem was outstandingly beautiful. You didn't have to go to Lebanon to see the majestic. You didn't have to go to California to see the redwoods. You didn't have to go see the giant, you know, stand. Solomon had it there. You come in Jerusalem and say, this is magnificent. There's no way to describe that, is there? Just kind of get a little vision of it. What beauty, Jerusalem. What beauty, the temple overlaid with gold. 35, 38-foot pillars at the front overlaid with the strength and beauty of entering God's presence. Just to say this, did you ever realize in the scriptures how they lost all that? It wasn't a progression. I wanted to go back and put them in order, so here they are. 1 Kings chapter 14, verse 21. And I'll tell you where it began to be lost, Solomon's son Rehoboam. 1 Kings 14. I'll try and keep these fairly quick. 1 Kings 14. Look at verse 21. And Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, reigned in Judah. Rehoboam was 41 years old when he began to reign. And he reigned 17 years in Jerusalem, the city which the Lord did choose out of all the tribes of Israel, to put his name there. And his mother's name was Naamah of the Ammonites. And Judah did evil. This is the nation, the southern tribes. And Judah did evil in the sight of the Lord. And they provoked him to jealousy with their sins, which they committed above all that their fathers had done. That's the passage of the sins of Rehoboam, Solomon's son. Now look at down at verse number 25. And it came to pass in the fifth year of King Rehoboam that Shishak, king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem. And he took away the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house, and even took away all that he took away all the shields of gold which Solomon had made. And here's the first pillaging of Solomon's temple. Now, there's other historical books. I'll just give you by way of studies that Rehoboam made this arrangement with Shishak because he was already at war with the northern tribes of Israel and he needed the finances. Now he just has Judah and some of the tribe of Benjamin. He doesn't have all the resources. So to obtain and get some of Egypt's help in this military league, they pillaged the Lord's house. And all the shields of the extra gold, that's what many consider the shields and the lining of the walls. This magnificent temple, those shields went down into Egypt. Those treasures of things overlaid with gold in the temple, a majority of them go down into Egypt. And then you read through this passage, which is a subject of many good messages, shields of brass for shields of gold. To make it a still, to make it a shiny place of worship, Rehoboam has the things that were once gold covered, he has them now brass covered. So let's leave that to another message. Have you traded gold for brass? We'll leave that as another message. But there's the first pillaging. 5 years after Solomon's death, the temple's being carted off because the people are in sin. Look down in 1 Kings 15, verse 18. Then Asa took all the silver and the gold that were left in the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house and delivered them into the hand of his servants. And King Asa sent them to Ben-Hadad, the son of Tabrimon, the son of Hezion, king of Syria, that dwelt in Damascus, saying, come make a league with me. I'm still at battle. This is Solomon's grandson. Wait a minute, I got that wrong. He's the grandson of Rehoboam. Grandson of Rehoboam. So 4 generations after Solomon, everything left of the treasures of Solomon's house are now being sent to Syria. The first load down in Egypt. Second load up in Syria. Folks, at one time these were the enemies of the Lord. These were the pagan nations. They now have. Oh, I should bring up by way of illustration. Just recently in the news, some of the museums in Berlin, Germany, and some of the museums of Europe have been made an agreement to return some of the treasures back to Iraq and back to Egypt that were taken when British rule British domain and empire, where they had taken the treasures of those countries and put them in museums in Berlin and one thing they're requesting back in Egypt to put near the site of the Great Pyramids is they want the Rosetta Stone back. The stone that translated the hieroglyphics into a language. The Rosetta Stone, they want it back. Countries pillage other countries' treasures. There's many lawsuits right now against some of the higher banking institutions of Switzerland of Jewish families wanting back their treasures that was stolen from them from Nazi Germany. They want them back. The treasures of Solomon's temple ended up in Egypt and Syria. That's fascinating, isn't it? But they still have the building. But they're about to lose the building. 2 Kings chapter 24. The Babylonian Empire made 3 military assaults against Judah. 2 Kings chapter 24, verse 10 is the first of those. 2 Kings 24, 10. I have a very short ending just bringing you through these things to show you what a tragedy this is. 2 Kings 24, verse 10. And at that time, the servants of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up against Jerusalem. The city was besieged. And Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came against the city, and his servants did besiege it. And Jehoiakim, the king of Judah, went out to the king of Babylon, he and his mother and his servants and his princes and his officers. And the king of Babylon took him in the eighth year of his reign. And he carried out thence all the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house, and cut in pieces all the vessels of gold which Solomon, king of Israel, had made in the temple of the Lord, as the Lord had said. Whatever was left, whatever was hidden, whatever was remade, this is how we read in the scriptures, whatever was left in Solomon's temple at this first invasion, Nebuchadnezzar took it. Cut it up pieces. Do you remember later Belshazzar would have this infamous feast, and he would bring out the treasures, the captured good things, the drinking cups, the instruments. He would bring out for his drunken feast to his gods the treasures of the house of the Lord in Jerusalem, and he'd get weighed in the balances. The third invasion, and there was three, and they were not far, separated by much. I think the first was in like 596, and the last one was like in 588. Within like a 14-year span, they came three times and kept raiding and pillaging the land and subduing it. But because of Israel's insurrection and trying to overthrow and not pay taxes into Babylon and everything that happened, the last one did this. 2 Kings 25, verse 8. And in the fifth month, on the seventh day of the month, which is the 19th year, the king Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came Nebuzaradan, captain of the guard, a servant of the king of Babylon, into Jerusalem. And he burnt the house of the Lord and the king's house and all the houses of Jerusalem, and every great man's house burnt he with fire, and all the army of the Chaldeans. I'll say this, the last of the three invasions from Babylon, there's nothing left to steal, but they don't want there to be any hope in the hearts of any of the Jews about having a home place. And guess what they do? They completely destroyed Jerusalem. And they burnt down Solomon's temple. And they burnt down Solomon's White House. They burnt down his throne house. They destroyed the walls and burnt the gates. Hence, we have Jeremiah's Book of Lamentations when he looks at Jerusalem and he remembers what it once was. Think of that. The glory of the trees, the parks, the glory of the peacocks, the glory, zoology, peacocks, apes, animals, silver, as everything overlaid with gold. He remembers what it was. He sees it now in its blackened state, and for five chapters, he weeps. Solomon's temple is gone. I can't even say that. No smile. I'm just saying it. That's really sad. I get sad when I go back and see the old farm place and the barns my brother and I played in. I see them all gone. And they were barns. You go back and the house the kids grew up in, 4435 Galloway Lane in Lakeland, Florida, at the end of a sand road with an orange grove on one end and a woods and a swamp in the back. I'd like to bring it up and show you a picture of it now with explosion of population in Florida. There's a highway that cuts back through that orange grove. The orange grove's gone, and a church bought the woods that's behind us, is building bought the 8-acre woods and is filled in the swamp. It's building a church right back in the woods behind our house. You can bring it up on Google and look at it and say, it can't be. So, but it's nothing compared to Solomon's temple and those that remember it. I go back to say this. Rehoboam's demise, they started losing the treasures inside and switching them for brass. What was left, Asa and Syria got that. What had been restored or even any remnants of that was the temple itself. Nebuchadnezzar would raise it to the ground. Of course, the remnant would return. They would build what Bible dictionaries call Zerubbabel's temple. Another way to remember it is the remnant's temple. It's the exile's return temple. Zerubbabel will be instrumental in having it built, so it gets that title. And those in Hosea who would see it being built would remember the old one. It says the ancients, the old people, that the few that survived and remembered Solomon's temple, they saw Zerubbabel's temple and they cry. I kind of think of in today's terminology, it ain't what it used to be. We remember the good old days. Little did they know that Zerubbabel's temple would, when Herod would come on the scene, within the, after the desolation of Antiochus during the intertestament period, by the time this Edomite king is appointed by the Romans over Jerusalem, he takes what's left of Zerubbabel's temple and makes it Herod's temple. Herod's temple was considerably bigger than Solomon's temple. Solomon's temple would be 3 to 5 stories high. Herod's temple was 15 stories high. Herod's temple, I can read the scriptures, John 2, verse 20. 46 years was this in building. A 46-year building project. It encompassed what is today a New York City, a city block. It didn't have one altar of sacrifice. It had 12. It didn't have one brass laver. It was lined with 6 on each side. It had quarters of rooms just to hold temple guards because they had to have their own armed forces to protect it. It was so grand and glorious. Jesus said, destroy this body, this temple in 3 days, I'll raise it up. They thought they were referring to Herod's temple, not knowing he's speaking of his body, the temple. See? But they'd say, no, it took 46 years to build that. There's no way you can build that in 3 days. It was glorious. And here we come to when Jesus is speaking in the great discourse that someday, at the end of the world, when shall these things be? And what will be the sign of thy coming? And when shall be the end of the world? Those are the questions of Matthew 24. Jesus said, they said, look at this grand temple. This can't be destroyed. Look at the glory of our worship. Look at. And Jesus said, there's coming a day where there won't be one stone left on the top of this. Folks, that's today. Now, I know how it happened. I've mentioned before the idea that we know what the furniture of the temple looked like somewhat because when Titus destroyed or captured Jerusalem in 70 AD, he hauled off the temple treasures of Herod's temple. And on the Arc of Triumph in Rome is the carved engraving of them carrying the menorah from the Jewish temple. So we got an idea really what it looked like. But the temple still stood. Herod's temple still stood. It had been pillaged. The Roman people had subjugated the Jews. But there was an attempted rebellion by the Jews, and by 135, Hadrian, another captain, another mighty general of the Roman Empire, came to Jerusalem and set it afire and set the temple on fire. Put wood and things in there so it would burn. And then as the gold melted off of everything that was left with gold to separate the riches of the gold from the stones, tore it apart stone by stone to get the gold. And not one stone was left on top of another of Herod's temple. That's been nearly 2,000 years ago. Nearly. I went through all that to say this. As grand and glorious as Solomon's temple was, and I'm comparing temple to temple, its treasures could be pillaged and lost. And eventually, those grand buildings could be destroyed themselves. Getting an idea here? What? Know you not that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, which you have of God, and that you're not your own? Yes, you're wonderfully made. Fearfully and wonderfully made. Yes, with great cost, purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ. But here's what sin will do. Sin will rob you of your treasures. Sin can separate you. What's your treasures in your life? Physically, what's your treasures? Family. Sin separates families. What's your treasures? Health. Sin can destroy your health. Really. What are you going to trade above those? Would you rather have your car than your family? Would you rather have your car or your house than your health? Kind of like to have your health, then you can get a nice house.
Health?
Sin can rob you of your health. Briefly, I was just getting ready to leave for the church a little earlier, came out on a TV show. One of the news stations was interviewing Pastor Jack or whatever, and he said, you know, remember we said like this, the main problem, you know, with all that's going on in the world, people are into drugs and people are into drinking because people are hurting and sorry out there. I walked out the door. I'd even shut the door, and I walked back and said, Tammy, that's not it. There may be a few people, maybe through a rare trial in their life, have a drink and have been a problem or a drug or something like that. But I'll tell you the main reason people are drinking and drugging and stuff like that, lust of the flesh. In the last days, men shall be lovers of their own self. This young generation's not out there partying and drinking and drugging because, oh, we're just having such a hard time. No, they're out there partying because they're having a good time. And they're self-centered. Let me give you a message. You've got one body. And it may be wondrously made, but you got one body, but sin will destroy it. It will rob you of your treasures. And the health you think you're going to have at 40 and 45, 50, 55, 60, build it one piece at a time, sound like John Cash. The treasures that you have now with your health and the treasures you have right now, sin will take it from you. And it may be in increments, but it will do it. And then you'll be robbed of those precious relationships you had. Why? That's what sin does. The wages of sin is death. The way of the transgressor is hard. And it's safe to say this, you'll never lose. God never loses his children. But I know this, God can chastise his children. You can lose your peace. Isn't it fun? Isn't it great to have peace? Isn't it nice to go and lay down your head on the pillow at night and have peace? Peace with God, peace with the world, peace with... Isn't it nice? You know what? You've probably had some sleepless nights before, but isn't it nice to have peace? Isn't it nice to have joy in your life? Isn't it neat to just go to bed and say, man, what a happy time? Sin doesn't give you that. It steals you that. And sin can also destroy the temple itself. Years ago, I was visiting a hospital. I've told some before this, so it was a bus kid's, Lakeland, Florida, it was a bus kid's dad. They said he'd been injured, so I went to the hospital, and they said, can you go see him? And yes, he'd been paralyzed. He'd been paralyzed for him and his buddy got to drinking. He's only 35 years old. Got to drinking. Got to thinking that they could challenge each other to jump over their pickup truck with their 10-speed bicycle. Sideways across the bed. So they built a ramp. And they're drinking, partying, having a good time. Got on his 10-speed bicycle. Shot up over the truck. Hit the other side. Didn't even think. He's riding a 10-speed bicycle. Bam! Hit the ground and shattered his back. There's several folks sitting there. Now, folks, what I say here sometimes, I'm a lot nicer than you think and more compassionate, and I keep my mouth shut a lot more than you think when I'm visiting folks. And the folks were sitting there, and they said, Brother Ray, why did this have to happen? And in my mind, I'm thinking, because you got drunk and tried to jump a pickup truck with a 10-speed bicycle. That's why it happened. Sin will make do dumb things and destroy your body. Same time, Tammy and I remember this, we had some young people who went for Daytona Beach Week. Parents in church even bought their room for them, rode and rented a room for them. Now, it wasn't them, but this same motel, teenagers did what they call balcony jumping. They're shot up on drugs, shot up on alcohol, and lo and behold, one trying to go from the 13th balcony to the 9th balcony missed. And everyone, why did this tragedy have to happen? Well, I would like to go back and say, for some foolish parents who rented a room for kids to have a drunken week, I call that message parental sponsored delinquency. Also, that's what sin does. Satan will try and rob you of your treasures. What? No, you're not. Your body's the temple of the Holy Ghost. Try and rob you of your treasures and destroy the temple. Bible's a lot deeper than we think, isn't it? And there's a lot of truths you can find when you read through that Old Testament and say, Look how he ties us to give us a living illustration how the progression of Solomon's great and glorious temple would eventually be gone. Let's leave it there. Come back Wednesday night. Pick it back up again about some wonderful, glorious look. Also what the temple of the Holy Ghost can be and have. Holy Father, thank you for this day, an opportunity to be in your house. Simple Sunday afternoon study, but what a truth. Lord, help us, we pray. Do the best we can, serve you. May the Lord's house continue to see souls saved and be filled through the days ahead till you come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. We pray and ask. Amen. Hey.